Task you have there.
Yes, but you know, if we put enough poison in the water, maybe they're gonna, you know, start to listen to us. But no, we're just the two guys that do this show. We try to do it every Sunday or Monday. Those are my off nights for now. My schedule switches sometimes, and basically the group is Haitian Free Thinkers. We are on Facebook, we are on Twitter, and everywhere that's important. I've been wanting to do something with you ever since we met on the Hangout, but the stars are aligned now, so we can talk about these subjects because now is the time. I think there's a really big energy or buzz going on, but like, for the wrong people going the wrong way, I think. And I think at the same time, there's an opportunity to talk about those things that that we like to talk about on Facebook. And we can have this platform as a way to not just have text, but like have people hear who we are and what it is that we talk about sometimes on our personal Facebook profile. So I thought it would be good to talk about it. And I'm grateful that you were able to join me. So thank you.
No problem. I'm excited.
All right. So I think the first thing to do is to introduce who you are, because I could read a little short bio, but I think it's always good for the person to talk about themselves. So who is Terri?
I mean, they always say in the South that it's really rude to talk about yourself, but, like, I don't have a problem talking about myself. I'm just a regular person. A mother, a wife, atheist, anarchist, anti-feminist. I have a lot of titles that just describe what I'm not. So, I mean, everything I would say describes who I'm not. Like, if you look at my Facebook, it's going to show you what I don't think, what I've trained my mind not to believe, the things that we've all been taught. And I think having, like, well, I guess what they say, an exotic look helps people, that catches the eye. I had someone tell me today, just based on how you look, you're going to reach 100 more people than what I would. I'm just an old fat white guy saying the same things you are. And sadly, that's true. You know, people like to see what they see. And so that helps people pay attention to me, whether it's on Facebook or in real life. I used to think I was self-conscious when I was walking. I was like, are people looking at me? Are people looking at me? And people would be like, yeah, they actually are. So I guess that's a big part of who I am.
So can you describe your look? Why, like, for those who can't see you or who's not your friend on Facebook, like, what's so exotic about Terri?
Well, I guess just you can't tell. I'm not, if you look at me, you wouldn't know. What race I was. I could be anything. I could be Native American. I could be Hawaiian. I could be, you know, Caribbean. And then I dress in a vintage style, anywhere from like early 40s to late 50s. And that's my everyday style of dress. And so I guess that kind of stands out.
Okay. And you were born in New Orleans, right?
I was born in Mississippi. A lot of my family still lives in Mississippi. I have family there, family in California, family in Louisiana. I have family in Detroit, in Indiana, They're spread all over.
Okay.
And then
James,
I lived in Detroit. Hey, I'm sorry.
I didn't mean to interrupt you as you were speaking. I wanted to check to see if my co-host was still on, but so that if you want to jump in, you know, please feel free. But
yeah, I was just sitting back listening to the description and everything. Talk about where she's from.
Okay, cool. You have family everywhere, but mostly you're based out of Mississippi. But now you live in New Orleans, right?
Yeah. I kind of grew up here, you know. My mother's here and everything. I spent my childhood Mississippi and here in Detroit a little bit. But, I mean, this is my home. This is where I live. This is where I raise my family. And there is no other home. Like, I go home to see my dad in Mississippi, but he only lives there because he moved there from here. So New Orleans is my home.
Okay. Let me see what else.
I have a question real quick.
Okay, go ahead.
I heard you say you're anti-feminist, and I was hoping that maybe you wanted, if you felt like, you know, digging more into that, because I was trying to figure out, when you say anti-feminist, explain that to me, if you don't mind.
Well, feminism, particularly third wave feminism, the current feminism that we see today on most college campuses, is a completely biased and contradictory doctrine. It is actually placing a woman on a pedestal, placing a woman in a higher position, making them more important than a man. The title in itself is biased, feminist. Starting with fem, you know, I'm a humanist. I'm for all people. And so looking at, you know, being around college students who are very liberal academia, knowing people who are feminists and seeing the direction that it went in, it's something that, you know, I just kind of had to take a step back and say, no, you know, I'm not a feminist. I'm for all human rights, you know. I can't say, you know, it's like, hey, we want equal rights until the ship is sinking, and then, oh, women and children first. That's not something I can agree with, because you're contradicting yourself. So, I understand first wave feminism, Susan B. Anthony, women's rights, completely. I'm totally with that. But that's kind of like human rights. We're at a point where this is like the richest country. Women in America are ahead of men in many things. Black women are the number one group of women graduating from college and going to law school. So, you know, the narrative that we're being fed, that women are constantly being oppressed and the wage gap and all these things, are actually false when it comes to us. If you go and you give your regular average third wave feminist in America some information about some real oppression that's going on somewhere, like in Saudi Arabia, they don't have anything to say. They're talking about a fake wage gap in America, you know. So I'm an anti-feminist, but I'm a humanist, and I'm raising sons, so I cannot support anything that looks at my babies as potential rapists. You know what I'm saying?
I like what you said, because I've had some experiences with some with women, and they, you know, it seems like, you know, and they say they call themselves feminists, and it's just like how you said, it's like basically putting the women above men instead of having it equal, just like how you said, and sometimes you'll see their posts, and it seems like they're always attacking, you know, men, even though, I mean, yeah, they'll take something small, but then apply it to just basically every man and basically say that we're all rapists. We just haven't committed it yet. I mean, it's like crazy.
You're all rapists. Every man is a potential rapist. But then when you turn around and say, what about the women that lie about being raped? It's, oh, my God, women wouldn't do that. Well, why would all men rape? So, you know, it's very contradictory. Feminism is something that you can rip apart at the shreds with just logic, third wave feminism. So it's something I can never support.
Let me give you a scenario. There was, you know, about the rape or what it was called, the rape up in New York with the girl and her father in the park and those five young black men, correct?
I remember the Central Park rapist.
Yeah, okay, so the girl, I guess, recanted her story, and people are, I guess the feminists are trying to say the cops made her recant because of some other stuff or probably made her recant. And I'm like, how do y'all know that? Y'all were not in the interrogation room with them. You know, I'm just happy those boys didn't rape her, then they're just coming up with all kind of scenarios and saying, oh, they still raped her, they still raped her. And I was just like, okay, whatever. I didn't feel like arguing.
Well, I mean, when you're dealing with a certain group of people, like liberals, feminists, and most feminists are liberals, there are a little group that claim to be anarchist, but anarchy and feminism are, like, fundamentally opposed. You can't, like, that doesn't even match. But most young liberals, I mean, young feminists are liberals. So when you are arguing with these people, they're coming from a place that's not always the truth, and they like to, like, skew the argument. What they automatically do if you get a leg up on them is start to attack you in the conversation because they're losing ground. Like, I do it all the time. Like, if I'm on social media or I'm talking to liberals in general, as soon as you start breaking down their points, they start attacking you. Well
they actually
kicked
me out of the group.
Well, yeah, that happens. It's completely crazy. It's completely crazy. And you know, it's all emotion-based. It's like everything they do is about emotion. It's like, oh, my God, I'm offended. Oh, my God, my feelings. Oh, my God, I need a trigger warning. Oh, my God, I'm triggered. Like, okay, get over yourself. I don't give a fuck about your feelings, and neither does the world. And I hate that we're living in a world where liberals are making it okay to act on emotion, where everything is about emotion. Like, I work on a college campus, and they have the little safe space stickers. This is not a safe space. This is the real world. You're not going to be coddled when you get out into the real world, you know?
Oh.
Awkward silence.
No. Oh. I was just letting y'all talk, because what happens is sometimes, like, people butt into each other when we're talking. So I'm just, like, I'm just listening to y'all talk right now. And y'all covered a point that I wanted to talk about, because I consider myself a feminist. And I was going to ask, to kind of segue to what y'all were talking about, for some definitions from Terri's perspective. What does she mean when she says she's an atheist? What does she mean when she says she's an anarchist? Because I'm not taking it for granted that people out there know exactly what she's talking about. So I like to start from definitions. So if you could define those terms for us, please.
Well, like I said, if you look at my Facebook profile or whatever, all of these words are telling you things that I'm not, or ideas that I don't buy into. So atheism, lack of religion. That's all that means, that without religion, I don't believe in an Abrahamic God. I don't believe in Buddha. I don't believe in white baby Jesus. I don't believe in any of that. What I believe is, you know, there may be something bigger than us. There may not be. As far as I'm concerned, it's humanity and we're all connected. But no, you know, all those holy books were written by a man. Don't believe it, you know. As far as anti-feminist, I believe I explained that already. I can't buy into some doctrine that's just completely contradictory and ridiculous. As far as anarchist, like, I started as on the path to voluntarism as a libertarian when I got involved into the Ron Paul campaign, and then I went door to door and I made phone calls and I actually met Ron Paul and I did all that great stuff. And then another friend of mine that you know And I like to say that he trolled me into anarchism by, you know, asking logical questions that I did not want to answer. So by anarchist, I just mean I don't believe that anybody has authority over me. No other man has any authority over me. The government has no authority over me. No,
not government even your husband?
Can, you know. No, we're equal and we respect each other.
Okay.
In a relationship. So I know my role and he knows his role. But at the end of the day, okay, nobody has authority over any other person except when you're raising your children. You do have authority over your children.
Okay. So we talked about anarchists, we talked about anarchy, atheists, anti-feminism. So those are things that you either are against or you're not. And you said you are a humanist, right?
Mm-hmm.
And humanist is what?
It just means it's kind of like a feminist, but for everyone. A humanist is the person that believes in humanity instead of God or instead of, you know, a higher power or religion. The reason why I kind of don't run in humanist circles is because they also tend to be liberals. Surprise! And I'm not a liberal or a conservative. I'm not political. I'm apolitical. So, but I am a humanist because I do believe, you know, in people. I believe in humanity.
Okay, I'm gonna torture you and ask for what do you mean by liberal?
A long time ago, liberal meant something different. But today, a liberal is your run-of-the-mill progressive Democrat, blue. It's hard to explain because the word actually means the opposite of what they do. A liberal thinks they know the best for everyone. They pander to the minorities and to women. They always have the black vote. It's like kids think that because you're black or because you're gay, you got to be a Democrat. Or because you were raised in the South, you got to be a Republican. So a liberal really, when I think of it, in my mind, I'm going to think of it different than anyone else. I think it's someone who thinks they know what's best for everyone and thinks they can make the best choices for everyone.
That's fine. So we'll work with those definitions, and I want to remind everyone that this is the Haitian Freethinkers radio show. My name is Reggie. My co-host James is in the back. We're talking tonight to Terri Coleman Williams. The guest caller number is 657-383-1619. Once again, that's 657-383-1619. If you are unable to catch this show live, you can listen to us on iTunes. The show is also available on Stitcher Radio as well as Spreaker. So if you have an Android device, you can download those apps and catch up on what you've been missing out on. If you're on YouTube, we're on YouTube, but also if you're on Facebook, that's where our group is at. Just search for Haitian Freethinkers and get in contact with us. So we covered a lot of the preliminaries. Now, so this is election season, and every 5 polls in general has something to do with the election. Anarchy is something that I can tell you about how I got introduced to it. It was actually during a show that myself and James were doing. No, that's not how I got introduced. I'm lying. Basically, there's a girl that you and I are probably mutual friends with. She posted a link on her wall, and I looked at it. It was like some kids that were in a classroom. They were pledging allegiance to the flag, and then they were given like some drugs. It was very sarcastic, which I love. And then I stumbled upon Lark and Rose's the plantation, the Jones plantation.
I love Larkin. He's great.
Yeah, so I stumbled on Larkin Rose's stuff, and the very first video I've seen of Larkin, I think I saw the first video of him was him doing a talk I want to say in Denver, and my first impression of him was that he was a crazy white boy, and I just couldn't believe that he's talking all reckless like that. I thought he was the kind of guy that lives in his car. You know, I visualized him living like in a hatchback and not really having much friends, and I didn't think that his philosophy had a lot of traction. So I started finding out more about him, and we were doing a show, James and I, and this guy called in, and he was like, yo, you cats are talking about Anarchy? That's crazy. I want you to check out Stephen Molyneux, and I just started to learn a lot about it, and then I eventually stumbled upon our friend Tyron, and I seen he had an interview with Jeff Berwick, I think his name is. So Tyron was in Mexico, and he was this big black guy, because I didn't know that was black anarchists, so that was kind of interesting. So I saw a hangout with Tyron, and I wrote him. I didn't think that he would reply back, and then we did our hangout, and that's how I met you, Jessica, etc. So anarchy is very interesting to me because just like atheism, growing up, it was not a good thing. It was not a good word. My first introduction to anarchy was around 2001 after 9/11. 2001, when I was told that there's this book called The Anarchist Cookbook, which supposedly is on this forbidden list of books to read, and that if you purchase the book, you'd be put on like some kind of FBI list because they're thinking that you're going to do something crazy, you know? So I instinctively knew that there was something about these people that were dangerous, and I didn't want to be associated with that. So I had no idea. Yeah, you know, early 2000, I was into kind of like what they call conspiracy theories. I read this book called The Biggest Secret by this author named David Icke, and that really influenced me. I bought into it. I was not in atheist at the time. I still consider myself what we call myself now a skeptical thinker. But, man, I really thought that there was something to what he was saying. And I was in a different place. And it's funny that you mentioned Zeitgeist because I also saw Zeitgeist, I want to say, in 2006, 2007 when it first came out. It was on the Internet. And that also made a big impression on me. I thought it was, like, again, just another big explosive documentary, and but by that time I was kind of burnt out because I didn't want to seem like the crazy person, and I thought Zeitgeist had the chance to break through from the Internet to mainstream, because where I was living at back in the day in South Florida, I heard that they even screened it at the local college, so I thought that that had a buzz, but eventually that kind of petered down as well. So, but I became an atheist in 2009. Humanism, I'm a humanist, and I've always been a humanist. I didn't, like you said, I didn't know what that was until someone explained it to me. This was in college, and my teacher, she's a Jewish humanist, not non-practicing Jew. She's basically an atheist. And she told me that's what she was, and when she explained, I'm like, yes, that's it, because I believe and helping pretty much everybody myself. So what I want to ask you is, like, so what were your influences? Like, how did you arrive at those different positions?
Well, okay. Growing up in the South, having a white mother and a black father, I already went through a lot, you know. I had a lot of struggles, so I was introspective, and I was a deep thinker. I always thought a lot. I was alone a lot because I was the only child. So, like, when they took me to church, I was like, this is just bullshit. This shit is not real. None of this is real. And I'm like, am I the only person sitting here thinking this? This is not real, you know, and obviously I was. you know. But I never, never bought into the Bible stuff. And I tried. I tried when I got older. I joined churches. I did all that. And finally, one day, I was just like, I just don't believe this stuff. I just don't believe it. And then I was married to my husband, and his dad's a preacher. And then he was like, you know what? I don't believe it either. And I never did. And I was like, oh, my gosh, I'm so happy. But
He became an atheist after the fact?
He was already an atheist. We never really said anything to each other about it, you know. Because I guess
were like
we were
in the
like...
closet atheists.
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly.
That's crazy. Then y'all just came out to each other. Oh, that's crazy.
Right.
That's love, though.
It is. It's really crazy because, you know, if it could have gone the other way, and it would have been an ordeal, you know. But as far as politics, like, to me, the news never seemed real. I always knew that it was a joke. I knew that there was something wrong. You know, it was a joke. Why do they always have the same news on all the channels in all the cities? But I didn't pay attention to politics because I was just living my life, having fun, being young, you know, early 20s. And what happened was, I used to think that it was difficult because, like, for most people who don't know, politicians use jargon and terms that we don't understand to make it sound more difficult than it really is. If you pay attention, then you can find out what's going on. But like I said, I got on Facebook, and I ended up coming across a guy from Georgia. He was from Florida, but he lived in Georgia. And he was like, you should look at this guy, Ron Paul, or whatever. And I'm like, okay, whatever. So I looked at it, and I was just like, you know, same thing you said, crazy white guy, you know. But then I started paying attention, and everything he said was in regular layman's terms that I could understand. So then he said, watch Zeitgeist. I watched Zeitgeist. And the most important part of Zeitgeist to me was the part on the banks and the fiat currency. And that it just hit home because that's a question you always ask. Where does money come from? And people will tell you, oh, well, it's, you know, there's all this gold in the bank. No, there's not. It's fake. It's false. You know, it's not real. It's fiat currency. They're, you know, our dollars are just dollars. They don't mean anything. And so that part of Zeitgeist really turned me on to studying, looking more into economics and reading Austrian economics and looking at, like, I read a book by, what is the guy's name? Always, but it's Capitalism and Freedom. And so it's an older book. It's really old, but it's been rewritten with new intros and outros and all that stuff. And the more I learned about economics, the more politics made sense to me. And I always knew it was kind of a game and kind of a joke, but now I know, like, it's really a game and it's really a joke. And it's all about not having the regular people just find out that it's all a game. Because it's just like Larkin's video, The Tiny Dot. It's a tiny dot that runs the world and everything, and all these other dots around it. Just say, okay, but when all those other dots realize, hey, you know, we don't have to listen to them, there's going to be a problem for the tiny dot, which is the government. And that's why I love Larkin Rose so much, because he has a way of putting things in words that regular people can understand. He doesn't sit up there and try to talk and sound all intellectual. He just is straightforward. He says words regular people can understand. They can turn it on. They can hear it, and it's going to click with them. And you don't have to know the terms we use all the time, because if you're on Facebook or if you're on Twitter and you're always in anarchist or voluntarist circles, you know, we use certain terms. We have inside jokes. We use certain memes. Like, you know, we say morodes and all that stuff. And just coming in from the outside, you wouldn't know what any of that meant unless somebody explained it to you. And I think that's the beauty of Larkin's writing, that it's just plain English and you can understand it. But, like I said, through Ron Paul and Zeitgeist, and then I met Kyron, of course, that took about a year for me to go from libertarianism to actually say the words, yes, I'm an anarchist. But, I mean, deep down, if I would have had the information, I always would have been.
I always think about when I was thinking of civic social studies in high school and middle school. I knew about certain options, democracy, and they always shitted on socialism and communism. But do you think that there's was my teacher ignorant about philosophies like anarchy, or was she forbidden to kind of like talk about it? I mean, is there you think there's a concerted effort to kind of silence non-traditional, I guess, information when it comes to like options as far as philosophies when it comes to government?
Well, I'm going to say no. I'm going to say those people were just completely ignorant to anything other than what they have been told, just like 90% of everybody in the world. They only know what they've been told, just like doctors. You can cure cancer. You can cure cancer yourself, some with simple stuff you can do at home. But do you think doctors know that? No, because they haven't been told that, you know. So I'm going to say no. Civics and social studies teachers, they use the curriculum that's given to them by the curriculum that was given to them. That's why we have a Department of Education, you know. So it may be kind of what you're saying, a concerted effort. But for the most part, schooling is a government institution right now. So they're, you know, that's why they say the Pledge of Allegiance at school, you know. So they're kind of training you. They're getting you ready. They tell you you're supposed to vote, but they don't teach you how to balance a checkbook. So, I mean, you just got to think about that. Now that we have the internet, I don't know how long ago you were in school, but you said you were in college and you saw Zeitgeist. Well, I was at the tattoo shop the other day getting a tattoo, and I met another young black anarchist, and he told me that his high school teacher showed him Zeitgeist, and that set him on the path to becoming, you know, more aware and gaining his own philosophies and things. So I think the internet, well, in my opinion, the internet is the greatest invention since humanity, since fire, the internet, because we can meet all these people. We can be talking on this phone and on the radio and on the internet right now about these things. So I think if teachers, when I was in school 15 or 20 years ago, would have had the internet and the information, maybe they would have been teaching the same stuff that, like, this little guy that I met, his teacher showed Zeitgeist. So, you know, the information has been out there for a long time. It's just been inside people's minds or in a book, in Ayn Rand's book, you know, or in Rothbard or Mises' book or something like that. Now it's on the internet and we can all get it. I think
What about this? What about, like, people like myself, you, James? Like, if we all went to the same high school, can you make an argument that we were born with a certain disposition that these kind of things would naturally attract us? So if you were to kind of map out our likes, I think that we're going to find that there are some things I'm sure we're going to differ about. There are a lot of things that we have in common. Is it because that we were kind of, I guess, not predestined, but we have these innate qualities that will attract us to things like anarchy or in atheism, for example? Or is it just a matter of information? Do you really feel that if more people knew about what you know, there would be more people like you and I out there?
Okay, so this is a hard question for me because I know for a fact I'm very introspective and analytical of everything, including myself. I know for a fact that incidences in my life and the things surrounding my upbringing influenced me to be the type of person I am and to be the type of thinker I am and to shun authority. So I think maybe there is something in certain types of people that's going to automatically buck the system or automatically, you know, drift toward thinking a certain way. But I think a lot more people would think that way or would be able to think for themselves if they were not indoctrinated from birth with God and country. It's God and country from the time you're born. It's the 4th of July and go to church. It's God bless America and I pledge allegiance to the flag from birth. You know what I'm saying? So it's indoctrinated into you. It's beat in your head every day from a kid. So, I mean, we don't know what it would be like if that wasn't occurring, because that's what occurs. So it's a hard question for me. So I do think that, yeah, a lot more people would be able to think for themselves if they had the capacity and the information like we do. But I also think certain types of people are always going to be the free thinker, or, you know, be the one to think for themselves anyway. Go lay down, son. Go lay down. Get in your bed.
Okay. I have another question. You know, like, with everything going on, do you think that celebrities should take more active stance in political situations? I'm thinking about two people in particular, Jim Brown and LeBron James. Now, the Miami Heat did a, like, a little picture after the whole Trayvon Martin thing where they all wore hoodies or whatever. Do you think that there's people out there that want to be more outspoken about different things, maybe some of the things that we are into, but they should, or are athletes or celebrities just part of the population in large, where they don't know some things that we know, and therefore it's not that they don't want to speak, it's just that they are not aware? Or is there some kind of fear of losing their status, if that makes any sense?
I think celebrities are paid to shuck and jive, so they should shuck and jive and keep their mouth shut, okay? That's their job. Just because a lot of people look at you and see you, that doesn't mean that you have any type of knowledge about anything other than learning those lines and going and standing and giving your award speech ceremony. If you're a rapper, rap, that's different. Now, if you're a conscious rapper or whatever, but music isn't what it used to be. Hip-hop started as a movement, you know, as a push against the system. But as far as celebrities, most of them are idiots. So, no, they should not take a stance. I can't tell people what to do. They can do whatever they want with their own money and with their own time. But we have all these people in America and in the world that look up to celebrities as if they're like, you know, they're real idols or something. They're like our royalty. So whatever they say, just like Beyonce with this formation stuff. Beyonce was a feminist like a couple, like last year or some shit, because she could jump on the feminist bandwagon, right? So now she's like black power because that's what everybody's talking about, right? So, and people can't see beyond that. They can't, you know, they can't see that celebrities do things to gain relevance or to keep relevance, or sometimes celebrities are puppets and they're being used to steer a narrative. You know what I'm saying? But no, I just think, you know, people can do whatever they want to do. I feel like I would say, sure, celebrities can say whatever in politics, but that would only be if we had enough people who were actually thinking for themselves to say, hey, you know, maybe I don't agree with that. But we don't have that. We have people who are just going to do whatever the celebrity does, say what they say, wear what they wear, go where they go, you know. And that's sadly, that's the culture we live in. So I don't agree with celebrities getting involved in politics, but I can't tell another person what to do or think or say. And that's the good part of being an anarchist. As long as you're not harming me, do whatever you're going to do.
Okay, well, is there any good things that government do in your opinion?
No, nothing.
Not one thing.
If they have to steal money from me, you or anybody else to do it, then it doesn't matter what they do with the money. The money was stolen to begin with, right? If they could take my money before I get it, then I'm a slave. So they're taking my money before I get it. So I've been stolen from, right, before I even get my check. So I don't care what you do with it in the long run. It started out wrong in the beginning.
Stolen money are, you know, I'm assuming that somebody out there who's going to listen or who's listening,
I'm talking about taxes. Taxes are stolen money. Taxation is theft. There's no way around it. Taxation is theft. I'm sorry.
But some people say, well, you know, it's part of the social contract, you know, the roads need to be
built. There's no such thing as a social contract. If you show me where I signed a social contract, I'll abide by it. There's no such thing. That's an imaginary thing. It's a fiction. It's a word used to try to make it okay to steal my money. There's no such thing as a social contract. I am not,
okay,
I am not obligated to. Go ahead.
I never remember.
Go ahead, Jane.
No, I was just saying, I was just agreeing with her. I don't remember the other side of the contract that said, yeah, I'm only paying a certain percentage of my money. Now, I'm pretty sure, I know we have to sign the tax form, but when you, if you tell the job, hey, you know what, I don't want to fill out this tax form, it's going to be like, okay, well, we can't give you the job then.
Well, there is a way. Okay, they're going to come after me for this, and I'm trying to do this in the process now. It takes about a year. There is a way that you can have all third parties withheld. They cannot take your money. Now, there's a way that you can keep the IRS from getting your money, but you have to be committed to doing it, and you have to, you know, you have to go through with it. There's a guy that sells a book for like $50 that tells you exactly how to do it.
This ain't the Wesley Snipes thing, is it? You know what I'm saying?
It's not Wesley Snipes. No, Wesley Snipes was just doing tax evasion, just regular old run-of-the-mill, I ain't paying my taxes type of thing. But you know what? Let me speak on that. There is no law that says individuals have to pay income tax. There is no law. There is a standing $50,000 reward right now for anyone who can produce the law that says individuals have to pay an income tax.
You mean
a lady named Sherry Jackson Peel worked for the IRS, and she went to prison because she put that $50,000 out there on the line. Because she was auditing people, she was raiding people's homes, and when she found out there was no law, she started telling people. She's on YouTube, you can look her up, Sherry Jackson Peel. And so they got her and put her in jail because she was telling everybody, hey, you don't have to pay this. There's no law that says you have to pay an income tax. You don't have to file a return. You don't.
So where do we get the notion that we do have to file a return from?
The same way that you get the notion that it, paying taxes is good and you have a social contract. It's just what's told you. It's just what you do.
It's kind of amazing to me how often we just go along with the program and don't even realize it. I'm sure I still do that sometimes, so I'm not going to sit here and pretend I'm some kind of, I figured it all out and everything.
None of us have figured it all out. We're just trying to get along. The main problem is they say, well, what's your solution? Just because I don't have a solution doesn't mean I don't know there's a problem, you know?
Yeah, that's what Kyron says. He's a cool guy, that guy. But for me, my epiphany came when I was living at home with my mother, and my youngest brother, he was whistling around me. And in the Haitian culture, it is considered rude for a younger person to be whistling around older people. So, because I've been indoctrinated to think that that was rude, I told my brother, hey, you know, don't do that around me. That's not cool. And my brother was like, why? Why is that rude? And I was like, you know what? I don't know, but I'm going to ask my mom. So I asked my mother.
And she didn't
know. My mother said,
she didn't know.
She did not know. And that's when it hit me. I'm like, oh, my God. Like, I literally felt, and I'm not kidding, I felt like a physical reaction to his whistling. Like, I felt like I was going to get hit if I did not stop him from whistling. Like, I wanted to hit him as well. Like, how dare you? Like, you don't know that. I take it for common sense that, you know, you don't whistle. So I asked my mother. She didn't know. So I went to church. And I found the oldest Haitian I could find. And I asked the lady, I said, hey, why is it rude, you know, when people whistle around elders? And she said that that's just the way it is. And that's when, like, I was like, oh, shit, like, how many of these things exist? You know, like, how often am I doing this thing? And I started to question everything. Like, one of the things that I questioned was, why is it? This might seem, like, minor, but like you, I was a thinking person. And I just, like, think about random shit sometimes. I used to be like, okay, this is one of my questions. Why is it that males have to have short hair and females have to have long hair?
And guess what? Guess what? Before you say that, my whole family, all my males have long hair. My husband, my children, all of us, we don't cut our hair. So that's just probably something, you know, with certain cultures.
Well, I, you know, growing up Haitian, you know, the thing is, I thought my whole world was black people. Like, I remember I was in the eighth grade when I found out, according to my teacher, that black people were a minority, which I couldn't believe. But I really did think that, you know, this was just the way that the world works. I didn't see any other real reason why, you know, some other culture might have males with long hair and their females with short hair, like a total reverse of what I knew to be the standard. But the first time I saw, you know, black people with long hair, it was probably some sort of Rastafarian Jamaican dread person. And coming from the Haitian perspective, these were some crazy minorities, you know, like from the Rasta Jamaican, like there were not a lot of them, you know? So I just thought that, generally speaking, wherever you go in the world, the male is going to have shorter hair and the female is going to have longer hair. And I questioned, like, who made this rule? Where did it come from? And you know, like, who gets to, like, make these rules up?
Well, that's good. I've always said, oh, gosh, I used that today, actually. I was at the zoo, and we were standing in line to get on the train, and I went and stood by the seat I wanted to get on, but I didn't get on the seat. And here comes this man, grown, tall, 6'2", and he was like, hey, you can't wait there if you don't have your ticket. And I said, where's that written? Who said that? Where's that rule? Show me. And he was just like, he got angry, and he went and got the little lady that drives the train. He was like, she's trying to hold a seat. And I was like, there's no rule that says I can't stand here and wait for my husband to come with the tickets. People just, they love authority. Oh, my God, people follow. And that, I think that's a big problem. People follow. They don't have to know who wrote the rule or where the rule came from. They just know it's a rule and this is what I got to do. That doesn't work for me in my life. I want to know why. And that's why, like, I have problems with corporate situations. I don't go along to get along. I want to know why. And if, like, something's wrong, I'm going to tell you it's wrong. I don't care if you're my coworker or if you own the company. I'm going to tell you, no, that's not right. And I think that's why I have a big problem with, you know, just society in general. People just go along. They just do what everybody else does.
Okay. All right. Well, are there any situations where you, like, the convention agrees with your personal philosophy, and so it works for you? This is what I mean, because, you know, with the anarchy thing, I think about it all the time. I really like the philosophy. I'm just thinking about more or less as far as, like, the everyday uses of it, if you will. And so, like, there's this big thing now as part of the political narrative, you know, Roe versus Wade, you know, pro-life, pro-choice, et cetera. So I happen to be pro-choice, right? So it seems to me that if, let's say, the Republicans win and they try to reverse Roe v. Wade, now they get to impose their philosophy on everybody else, and a lot of people are going to be unhappy. So my question to myself is, and I'm kind of asking you, is what happens am I a hypocrite where, like, the narrative fits what I think is good? Am I, like, a hypocrite? Because I think we should have the freedom, in this case, to have the choice to make this decision, even though it's difficult. But right now it's the law of the land. So if they reverse it, am I being a hypocrite because I happen to like what the Supreme Court ruled as far as that particular issue?
Okay, so I'm gonna tell you like this. You can't be a hypocrite with anarchism because it's not a narrative. Voluntarism is not a narrative. Freedom is not a narrative. It's just a way of being. So if you use logic in your life to make your decisions, and it's logical and it's reasonable, at the end of the day, whatever you choose, then it's not a narrative, okay? A woman should be able to choose what she wants to do with her body. That's her choice. You know, that doesn't have anything to do with anyone else, Republican or Democrat. That's just her choice, right? So, no, you're not a hypocrite just because you feel like people should be able to do whatever they want to do with their own bodies. I feel like that too. Because at the end of the day, the Republican Party and the Democrats are the same thing. They never change major issues. You have the same policy term after term after term after term. You have the same foreign policy term after term after term after term. They pull at the little strings like Roe versus Wade and Planned Parenthood and things like that just to keep us at odds, the little people, you know, the people that buy into it. They're really not going to ever change anything. And then say what you say happens and a Republican is elected. You really honestly think there's not going to be a market out there for abortions? There's always, the market is there. The market is what we live in. There will always be someone doing abortions, regardless of whether it's legal or not legal. Just like there's still a guy selling loose cigarettes on the corner. Just like there are people making moonshine in dry counties and selling beer. Where my daddy lives, this is dry county. He's an alcoholic. There's a moonshiner right down the street with a freezer dug into the ground with beer in it in the backyard. And then he goes down the street and buys his beer, and he doesn't have to travel to the next county. There's always going to be whatever you need at your disposal. Marijuana is illegal. I can walk down the street two houses and get marijuana. So whatever happens in government, there's always going to be a market. But to answer your question, no, you're not a hypocrite. You feel like people should be able to do what they want to do, and that's what it is.
Well, I think there's a difference between there is a market for X and whether or not it's legal or illegal. If they make it illegal to have an abortion, yes, I agree with you that there's going to be a market, but now they're going to try to infringe upon the person's desire to do this thing. What does the person who's against that policy do? Do you think they're just going to be trained to obey authority and go along with it? Or what do you think is going to be the repercussions?
Well, I can't say what any individual is going to do. I can't say what anything that's going to happen about anything. But I can say for everything the government does, there's a market solution. Just like, and then to touch on that note a little bit more, healthcare is not a right. You do not have a right to health care. You do not have a right to the services of another person. That's the work, blood, sweat, and tears another human being has to do. So, no, you don't have a right to health care. You should be able to get health care, and with the market working, you will be able to get it. Just like now, we have the Affordable Care Act. There are five different places in New Orleans right now who no longer accept Medicaid, Medicare, or insurance. They only take cash. You pay $50 a month or $75 a month, and you go to the doctor as much as you need to go if you're old and sick. If you're young, you pay one price when you go, and that includes your medication. So, like, I don't know. Roe versus Wade is a hard one. They can overturn it, But states, that's a federal ruling, right? So states' rights still trump federal ruling. So states will still be able to do it, to have abortion in their state.
I think federal rulings trump states. So
no,
I think
states' rights trump federal rulings.
Are you
sure?
You're
going to have to go back and look them. They do. States' rights trump federal rulings.
The reason why I say that is because, you know, with the recent Supreme Court decision to legalize gay marriage, there was a lot of Christians who said that, you know, that went against state rights. There's some states that are very much against gay rights, like the whole Kim Davis thing, for example. So there, I think Ted Cruz and his people are trying to appeal to state rights to say, like, the big government cannot tell smaller government what to do.
But
so
that's actually
can...
right. Big government cannot tell the states what to do. The federal government cannot tell the states what to do. The states were always meant to govern themselves and have their own rights. They were supposed to be like small individual countries. That's why each state has their own constitution and their own different laws. States' rights always trump federal rights. The federal government does not always adhere to that, but that's the way it is when looking at the law.
Okay, I could be wrong. Let me do the aforementioned plug. This is the Haitian Freethinkers radio show. My name is Reggie James. Is watching the fight. You are listening to Terri Coleman Williams. If you wish to call in, the guest call-in number is 657-383-1619. Once again, that's 657-383-1619. We are on Facebook. We are on YouTube, Twitter, Google+. You can check us out on our website, HaitianFreethinkers.org. You can get in touch with us by emailing us at HaitianFreethinkers@gmail.com. And also I have a Google voice number for those of you who want to talk or text. That number is 678-820-9474. Once again, that's 678-820-9474. Heck, we even have WhatsApp, like a group going for HFT. I'm trying to make it available for everybody, for those who want to get in touch. So this is your chance to call in to talk to Terri if you have any questions for her. But I had sent you, well, we talked about certain questions, but we've covered
mm-hmm.
so much ground that I'm going to see if I'm going to trip you up still, even though you should be prepared. Okay, so I like this one. If each state took turns legalizing weed, what number would Louisiana be?
Well, Louisiana is actually in talks right now. We've had several bills put forth about legalizing marijuana, decriminalizing marijuana, in medical marijuana, and recreational. So, I mean, I'm going to say it like this. Louisiana's different. Louisiana's kind of a state where do what the fuck you want to do, and we're not worrying about what you do. But since Katrina, a lot of liberals have moved here, young liberals, and we have the gentrification, things are changing. So all of a sudden we got a smoking ban. We've always smoked in bars. We've always walked down the street drinking alcohol, things like that. But now they keep bringing the medical marijuana to Baton Rouge. So it could happen, but it might not happen. It could. I think the thing that's driving Louisiana to do it is the fact that Colorado has such a positive their schools are number one now. They're like in the surplus. They had so much money that they're sending checks to citizens and things like that. So I think Louisiana is really looking at how much money Colorado made, and they may follow suit, but I can't really say. If you would have asked me that a year ago, I would have said last, but because of Bobby Jindal or whatever. But people hate Bobby Jindal, and he's almost out the door, and they keep putting the bills forth, so eventually something's going to happen with Louisiana and marijuana. I mean, everybody – go ahead.
I'm sorry, Trentor. I was going to say, if you had to guess a number, where would you guesstimate, you know? Because I think that right
I mean,
now
we're
only
at like
Colorado.
Four. Right, because we're only at like four or five right now. It's like Colorado, California, It's like two other places. So it's only like four or five. So I really can't even give you a number because I don't know. That's something I completely don't know. I mean, what I do know is if you come to New Orleans, people are going to be walking down the street smoking weed like it's legal anyway. So it really doesn't matter.
Okay. What exactly is medical marijuana?
Medical marijuana is just marijuana that they grow. You have special growers, and they grow it inside with the hot houses in, like, hydroponic tanks or whatever, and it's just, like, different strains. And it's the same thing people are smoking right now. There's no difference. It's high-grade marijuana. Back in the day when my granny used to get it, she used to get a prescription, and they would give her, like, a pill bottle, a fat pill bottle with rolled-up cigarettes already in it that was weed cigarettes. But now it's just the same thing people are already smoking in the streets. It's just high-grade marijuana.
Do you think there's a racial component to this whole marijuana thing?
As far as what? Everybody smokes weed. Like,
well, how do I articulate it? Like, with marijuana, like, I saw, like a documentary on the history of marijuana and why it's illegal in the United States.
Well, it's illegal because during Prohibition, Mexicans came up here to work and they brought marijuana, and that's how marijuana became illegal. Because people were smoking it instead of drinking after Prohibition ended. Because during Prohibition, they were smoking marijuana because they couldn't, they didn't want to drink the gut rot whiskey that people were dying from. So they started smoking marijuana that Mexican workers brought. And then when Anheuser-Busch found out after alcohol was legalized again, after, Prohibition was stamped out, they found out people were smoking marijuana and they weren't worrying about drinking because you could smoke marijuana and not be sick the next day. Anheuser-Busch put out the smear campaign for marijuana, and that's how that happened.
Right. That's basically what I learned from the documentary. But what I was talking about was, there's a high rate of black incarceration in the country. Sometimes for drug possession with marijuana, but like some people feel like basically it's white people who kind of are in charge of the laws or whatever. Now that they figured out how to make money from it, all of a sudden a lot of the lives that were ruined for drug charges now, what's going to happen with them? Because it's kind of like the powers that be just now decided like, okay, it's legal at least in a few states.
Well, I mean, just with anything else, I mean, it's changing and things will have to change along with it. We can't say what's going to happen. Are they going to pardon nonviolent drug offenders? Are they going to let them out of jail? Are they going to – I doubt it. I mean, who knows what's going to happen? Of course, the drug war is a huge problem for minorities. You're more likely to get targeted by police if you are a minority, even though, there are just as many whites in jail for, simple marijuana as there are blacks. But when you go up to crack and cocaine, that's when the disparities start coming in as far as jail and prison and all that, and prison time, term, and sentences. But, I mean, of course there are going to be issues that would have to be addressed now, if marijuana became legal for everyone. But I can't say what the government is going to do because, after all, the government is just a bunch of self-serving individuals, and they're going to serve self, right?
Okay. Let me see. What are your three favorite books of all time?
This is a hard one. I was actually thinking about this question earlier before you called me, before I fell asleep, because I had fell asleep, and I had to set the alarm to wake me up because, I'm an old lady, and I like to go to sleep at 8 o'clock. But
it's all good.
I know. I don't really have favorite books. I mean, I stopped reading fiction a couple of years ago. So it's really hard to have a favorite book when you don't read fiction. So I'm just going to name, a couple of books that I feel like I read that stood out or were important. So the last book I read was Thomas Sowell's Intellectuals and Race. And I think everybody should read that book because it talks about liberal academia.
Hold on, let me Google that. Thomas?
And it's available on Audible. Thomas Sowell. He's also called an Uncle Tom, like me. You know, he's a black person who speaks out about liberals and Democrats, but conservatives as well. But he takes a stance against things like feminism or, you know, liberal academia, the way that liberals have completely brainwashed college students, you know, and you don't have any conservatives teaching schools. In colleges, it's a minority. But he talks about economics. He talks about how the civil rights movement changed when he talked. It's not exactly how it changed, but how during slavery we had, you know, a lot of black families that were whole families, married, man, woman, children, and how when the new civil rights bills were introduced, that really broke up the black family, and how now we're feeling the effects of actually the civil rights movement, and how when the government made it an incentive for men and women not to be together, we're feeling those effects with, you know, 75% broken homes and single parent households within the black community. So he's looking at it from the same perspective. Go ahead.
I didn't want to get too far, so I don't forget this. How did the government make it an incentive for the family to break up?
Well, in 65, 67, when the new civil rights laws were passed, they gave women food stamps, welfare money, and rent as long as there was no male in the household. And those policies are still in place today for the most part. They slacked up on them, but, like, if you have Section 8, they don't want you to have a male in the household. It's supposed to be just the women and the children. It changes once there's a male in the household. So that's in 1967 when the new Civil Rights Act was passed. From then until 87, when the crack epidemic hit, and like that, like, was like a burst. It went from, okay, already we don't have males in the household, now crack is in the streets and people are selling crack. All of these things have contributed to the mindset and the culture that we have today in the black community, or whatever you want to call it, you know, black people. I can't even say the black community, because it's just, people are just individuals. There's no real black community. We don't represent each other. We can only represent ourselves. But we are stereotyped and put into groups and collectivized. But back to the question, the three books. Thomas Sowell's Intellectuals and Race is very important. It's really a good book. I think everybody should read it. Another book that really hit home to me when I first really started looking into biology and evolutionary biology was The Greatest Show on Earth by Richard Dawkins. And a lot of people don't like Richard Dawkins because he's like one of the new atheists, the four horsemen. They say he's an asshole. I think he's hilarious. He's so funny to me. Like, his books, I'm reading his books. I love Richard Dawkins. He's a staunch liberal, but he'll be all right, you know. He's funny, but The Greatest Show on Earth really takes evolution and breaks it down and explains to a lay person how evolution can occur within 40 years. And they have pictures, so it's great because there's pictures in the book. So I'm going to give you four books. Okay, so the third book is Consciousness by Sam Harris. This is another one of the four horsemen, the new atheist. He talks about Eastern religion, Buddhism, things like that. And, you know, he's a neuroscientist and an atheist at the same time. And that really interests me because I'm interested in the brain, how the brain works, how emotions work. So he just talks about consciousness and then what is consciousness and what is it to be alive? What is it to think? What is thinking? What is feeling? What is emotion? And that's what that book is about. And the last book I'm going to give you is actually one of my favorite books that I actually read when I was in, like, the seventh grade. And it's Homer's The Odyssey. It's one of the classics. So it was hard for me to read in the seventh grade because I was like, you know what I said? I gave myself a challenge. I said, you know what, Terri, read this book. And I was like, this book is hard because, you know, it's like it's in sonnet form or whatever. But and it's translated from Latin to English. It's kind of funny. It's weird. But I love Homer's The Odyssey. And, you know, you ever see the movie, my favorite movie, like, Oh, Brother, Where Art Thou? It's based on Homer's The Odyssey.
That's an actual movie?
Oh, Brother, Where Art Thou with George Clooney? Yeah. You got to watch that. It's hilarious.
You're giving me so much information. I have to Google one at a time, but... Let me go ahead. Yeah, there it is. Oh, brother, where are they? I came up fast. My goodness. Do I need to know the Odyssey before I... do I need to...
Well, if you're going to read the Odyssey... I don't know. No, you don't. I mean, it's just going to seem like a movie to you, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to read the Odyssey, I mean, read it. Everybody should, I guess. I don't know.
Okay.
It's boring. It's a boring book. Go ahead.
That's fine. It's fine because the Odyssey is one of the books that, you know, it's a classic. You know, like being a nerd like I am, being an atheist, you know, we hear about, you know, whether or not, you know, we should trust the Odyssey because, you know, it's not well attested compared to the Bible, this, that, and the third. But I never read the Odyssey. The only thing I know about it is that, you know, Homer goes on a quest. There are mermaids and these sirens try to like them. Is that correct?
Mermaids and giants and ships and storms and... sirens, gods, and goddesses, and they're always talking about libations. Yeah.
So now, you know, I got to get my game up because if we're having like a drunk party and we're doing trivia, I have to win. That's the kind of guy I am. So the next question is, would you pose for Playboy?
This is another question I thought about. So I'm going to say no, but I'm going to explain. Nudity has been sexualized. Now, I walk around my house naked. I take showers and baths with my sons and my husband. We all take baths together. Nudity is normal to us here. We're not nudists. We don't go outside like that, you know. But it's not an issue. I was raised, I had an aunt, and she never wore underwear. She never wore clothes in the house. She was just like how I am now. It was normal to us. Nudity has been sexualized in the society that we live in. So I don't think Playboy should even be a thing. It shouldn't even be an entity. It shouldn't be a magazine. We should not look at the female body and think, oh, my God, sex, 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 because nudity is the default position of humans. We're born naked. We put clothes on. And don't get me wrong, I love clothes. I don't know if you've ever looked at my pictures. I love clothes, fashion, style. I'm a female drag queen all day, you know. But as far as I'm concerned, we should not have, like, the human body shouldn't be sexualized. It's normal to be naked. It shouldn't be a taboo. You pick up the Playboy magazine and it's a taboo because you get to see all these naked bodies, but it shouldn't be because really, if we didn't have religion and religion had not shamed us into putting on clothes, we would see all the naked bodies all the time because we would just run around naked and it wouldn't be a big deal, right?
There's a point to that because there are nudist colonies and people that are into that. And I like to stretch my mind to figure out, you know, how it is that they do what they do. But the root of that question was that I was watching YouTube, and one of the members of the Young Turks news program, a young lady, she was asked to pose for Playboy, and then they asked her, like, point blank, like, would you do it? And she said no, because she's just starting in the business, and she didn't want that to be, like, what she's known for, or, like, it might be bad for her career. But I was thinking, like, Playboy seems to be, like, this high-end magazine or whatever the case is. So I wasn't sure if how different women thought about it, because some people might look at it as an honor. Some people might look at it as, like, why? Or why would you try me like that? Like, I was kind of afraid of even asking you the question, because some women would be like, how dare you even talk to me like that? Like, what do you think I'm, you know? So I just wanted to get your perspective on that perspective. You know, is it an honor? Is it a try? You know, so... But you gave a really in-depth and interesting question.
For me, I don't have a Playboy body. That is not the type of body I have. And so that's another question that I would, you know, say, why do they all look exactly the same? If we celebrate the body, why don't we celebrate the body? Why do we only celebrate a certain body type that looks like a prepubescent 12-year-old girl with huge boobs? You know what I'm saying? So
maybe it's supply and demand. You know, it's the market.
No, it's that. That's a created market. That's not even real. I don't. I really don't think, because if you look at the internet now, okay, they didn't have the internet when that was introduced. Look at the internet now. What do you see? You don't see nothing but big old booty, small waist, all over the place, all over the internet, right? You don't see the little flat, prepubescent 12-year-old looking girls with big boobs all over the place. Nobody wants to see that anymore. White guys don't even want that anymore.
Oh, okay.
I mean, some do. But, I mean, that's the conversation my husband and I had today when we were driving from the zoo, and we saw this girl, and she just looked like a stick. She just looked like a little boy walking down the street. And she thought she was just the sexiest thing ever. And he was like, you know, white boys don't even want that anymore. They want ass now. Like, okay, yeah, you might be right.
Okay. Well, ass is always good, and I support that fully. Let me see. You're just like a good conversationalist. I'm actually trying to trip you, but looks like you're on top of your game. yeah, I can. I'm working
and
on
I'm
it.
Drinking. And I'm drinking. So, yeah, I'm on my A game.
Yeah, you know something, like I was, you know, like actually before I come on, I try to get a little drink, but that's good. So you're on top of your game. So how about this one? Seven signs, and I think I know what you're going to say, but I'm going to try anyway. Seven signs that Terri Coleman Williams is ruling the world.
There's no sign that I would ever rule the world, because I don't want to be ruled, so I wouldn't rule anybody else.
Just come on. I knew you were going to say that. I knew it, but I'd still try to put that question in there, because we can still influence the world. Like, you influence your sons, you influence your husband, you influence people on Facebook. I would say, for example, one sign is you say you would tell people about anarchy, and you will tell people about, you know, fashion and tattoos.
Okay, I do right now. Listen to me. I do that right now. So I don't need to rule the world to do that. If somebody said, here, Terri, here's the world. It's yours to rule. My first thing would be, there are no rulers. I don't rule you. You are your own person. Now, the great thing is all the idiots would fucking die. They would just die. Good, they're out of the way. We can move on with our peaceful society without all of the people into their feelings and all of the idiots who need warnings to do not do this, do not place bags over your head, things like that. I think the government really has handicapped people. The government has incentivized and rewarded the worst of the worst, the least capable of reproducing to reproduce. So, like, you can be handicapped with a 65 IQ, get pregnant. The government's going to give you some food stamps and some welfare, and there you are, and your baby, handicapped, 65 IQ, and their baby is going to be just as crazy. So that's the problem I have with government. But like I said, no, I'm not going to rule the world. I'm not going to rule anybody. I don't have to rule anybody because persuasion works way better than force.
Okay. What about this question? What are people's first impression of you when they see you, especially when they haven't heard you speak?
Well, people usually say, oh, I love your dress, or oh, you look so pretty, oh, you're beautiful, you're gorgeous, you're put together. These are things I hear all the time. But I would say, like, if somebody has seen me on Facebook or they know of me but they don't know me, sometimes they would be apprehensive to talk to me because they think I'm just going to be this mean person, like, because, like, really, I don't have a filter on Facebook, so when they do talk to me, they realize, you know, hey, maybe I'm pretty cool or whatever. I'm trying to become, you know, I work every day on my humility. I work on my ego. I don't want to have an ego. I want to get out of my own head. I just want to be cool. You know, I stop taking myself seriously. But I would say people usually compliment me on something because if I do take the time to get dressed, then I'm going to be put together from head to toe. So usually the first thing, like if they've never met me and never seen me before, it's like I walked in the zoo today and the lady was like, oh, I love that dress. So, like, I really try to present myself anywhere I go, as well as my children. I am presenting them because they represent me. We are representing our family, and my husband has a nonprofit, and we're representing that. So when people first meet me, they usually give me a compliment if they say anything at all. They might just stare and not say anything at all.
And what is your husband's nonprofit?
It's called Lion Pride. It's basically, okay, I don't want to give too much away, but the idea is to cater to the youth of our community in New Orleans. The ultimate goal in the long run is to teach children about anarchy and to not trust the government.
Oh, subversiveness, huh?
Huh? But we're doing it like kind of like a social club. We're going to have them. We're going to, you know, we do like little cleanups. We're going to clean up the community, pick up the trash, take donations for charity. We've done all those things. We're doing another cleanup soon on the 19th. We're going to make it interesting to them, so because we'll say, hey, we'll march in the Mardi Gras parades, things to make kids want to join. And then when we suck them in, then we'll get in their heads with the, hey, you know, fight the man type of thing.
There you go. That's exactly what we're trying to do. I told you from the beginning, I dropped my keyboard, my bad. I feel you. I'm all about it because that's what other people do with other things, and so you already got my support. Just tell me what is in the check. Now, there's one thing that you do that we have not discussed. When I visited your profile, you apparently do marriages, is that correct?
I do, actually. Okay, so there's a little backstory. About 2 years ago, I started seeing, okay, so that's when they started really talking about gay marriage a lot. You know, it became the narrative in the news. And then so all the articles, the negative articles started popping up. And so I was seeing all of these articles about gay couples being turned away at churches, about transgendered people at their funerals where their mom put the wrong clothes on them and dressed them as a guy when they lived as a girl. And so all these things were, like, really weighing in on me. And so I was like, shit, what could I do? I want to marry people. So I went and got ordained in Universal Life Church to do weddings and funerals. So it was geared toward homosexuals. But then I said, hey, I'm an atheist. If I wanted to go get married, I would feel some type of way walking into a church talking to a preacher about marrying me, a person who doesn't believe what he's saying. You know what I'm saying? So then I was like, that would be good. I can do atheists and gays. And so it's really Tallulah's Weddings and Funerals for Heathens and Homosexuals. So I put those, that's a little comedy spin on it. But it's really geared towards non-religious weddings. So even if you are religious and you want me to marry you, I'll still marry you. I just charge you $50 for saying the word God extra because I don't believe in God. Because I don't discriminate. So, I mean, you see what I'm saying? I got ordained because of discrimination. So I don't want to discriminate. I'm just going to use the market in my favor.
And how's the business going?
I do about one a month, and so in the slow seasons, it's picking up right now. So really, it's wedding season right now. What happens is people underbid me because I get most of my business from Thumbtack. If you've never been on Thumbtack, it's excellent. If you need any type of work done, you can go on Thumbtack and find and get five different people to give you five different quotes, and you go with the cheapest one. So it works out good, you know, for the most part during the slow season. But when it gets busy, like this season, I just did one the other day. I've got another one coming on the 19th, and I've got another possible. What happens is people start going under, way under my base rate. And, like, I'm not going to charge less than $150, you know, because I just feel like I would be cheating myself. But people, like, charge $75, $80, $100. And I try to keep mine at 150, but when people read my profile on Thumbtack and they see that I was ordained specifically to marry gays, atheists, transgender, then they usually choose me because they know I am exactly who they want. I don't have to go and they don't have to give me a big spiel about, okay, well, I don't want you to say this and I don't want you to say God and I don't want you to say heaven and I don't want you to say this because they know already I'm not going to say that. I say Jesus because I say, oh, Jesus, because we live in the South. My son woke up, and he's all in the conversation now.
Okay.
But, yes, I marry people.
We have about 19 minutes left. I'm thankful that you're rocking with us tonight. I'm having fun. I hope you're enjoying yourself. This is the Haitian Free Thinkers radio show. Once again, if you want to know about us, you can find us online. Our website is up now, HaitianFreeThinkers.org. The guest calling number, if you want to call to speak to myself or Terri, is 657-383-1619. And I'm learning so much. I just learned about the website. I've learned about Mr. Sowell. And
Thomas Sowell.
So
yes.
Many. Yeah, Thomas Sowell. And I saw the book online, so I'm just going to keep tabs. I'm going to go back and listen to the podcast because there's a lot of information coming out. So let me see. The next question is, if you were going to be deported to a non-English-speaking country, which would it be?
Well, seeing as how I only speak English, it really wouldn't matter where they sent me. Now, my kids speak Spanish because I made it a point to make sure they speak another language. I want them to know how to play one instrument at least and speak one other language at least. But, like, if I got deported, I mean, like, send me to Bora Bora. I'm cool. I'm just going to live on the beach and eat some fish. Be like on Blue Lagoon. You ever saw that movie, Blue Lagoon?
Actually, no.
Some stuff from the 80s. It was from the 80s. But, I mean, it wouldn't matter where they sent me. But, I mean, send me to an island somewhere. That's it.
Okay. What about this? Which historical figure would you like to interview?
Okay, now, I thought about this question because I was, like, really trying. I was like, Terri, you got to say something great. You got to say, like, Cleopatra. You got to say, like, Napoleon. But, like, I can't even say none of that. Freddie Mercury, that's the only person that I want to interview. It's Freddie Mercury from Queen. The end of the day, it's Freddie Mercury. I love Freddie Mercury. That was the dude right there.
Tell us about Freddie Mercury.
Freddie Mercury was the lead singer of the greatest rock band ever, Queen. They were from England, and they were gay. And nobody knew they were fucking gay. And their name was Queen, and they sung about gay shit. And they had the whole world rocking along to them, never realizing their name was Queen and they were gay. Like, that was some shit people had to realize later on when he died of AIDS.
Right. I just Googled him and I looked at his picture and I was going to ask you straight up, like, is dude gay? But yeah, so boom.
That's
so
the greatest rock
band
of all time. Like
I mean, I'm learning all the time and I'm thankful that you are exposing me to this. And it says right here that, do you know where he was born? Because where he was born is so unexpected.
Yeah, he was born on a little island.
He was born in Africa. That's the clue.
I thought he was born on an island, but he grew up on an island or something like that.
He was born in Tanzania.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
He lived
just
in an orphanage, though.
I'm not sure, but it says here he was born in Tanzania. Richard Dawkins was also born in Africa, but that's just like, that's nerd porn right there, if nobody knew.
I know, all these white Africans.
Yeah. Gosh, okay, what about this? Let me try this one. I think I know one of your answers, but what are your three favorite foreign languages?
I don't have any favorite foreign languages because I don't speak any. I think Italian is beautiful. I mean, I hate Vietnamese because they always talk about me when I'm getting my nails done. I know they're talking about me. But really, I don't have any foreign languages because I don't speak any foreign languages. Like, I tried to learn French. It didn't work. I know, like, one sentence in French. My kids speak Spanish, but, I mean, I guess I think I'm just going to say Italian is beautiful. French is okay. It sounds like it got like a like coal or something in the back of the throat when they're talking.
Okay. What do you think of Donald Trump?
I think he's an actor. He's well paid. He's doing what he's supposed to do. He's a player on the stage, and he's catering to the people, saying what they want to say. He's an actor, just like all the rest of the politicians. They are actors. They are the ruling class. They're doing what they're supposed to do. They're playing their role. Their main goal is to keep us from figuring out that they're playing a role.
So the people that support them, are they stupid? Are they, how would you describe Trump supporters?
Half of them are stupid and half of them are severely misled, the same way with Bernie Sanders supporters, the same way with Hillary, the same way with anybody who supports any candidate. They're supporting crimes against humanity. They're supporting war. They're supporting things that are not conducive to healthy living. Like, government is violence. Like, that's the only thing I can say. They are the ruling class, and they feel like they have the authority to rule over us. That's not healthy, because I know they don't have that authority. They're just a regular person just like you or I. The problem is the people who vote for them believe they have that authority, and half of them believe they have that authority.
What was the last movie that made you cry?
Oh, gosh. Okay. Two movies I watched last week made me cry. The last one I watched was The Danish Girl. Do you know anything about that?
That's on my phone. I've seen it. I just see two pretty women, and I have no idea what it's about. Maybe lesbians? I don't know.
Okay, the Danish Girl is about the first ever transsexual surgery to happen. It was a man and a woman in Denmark. They were married. They lived in Copenhagen. The guy was a little feminine, whatever. But they were married, and it was like 1910 or something. So, you know, men were feminine. French men still wore powdered wigs and shit on their face in rouge and stuff. So one day she asked her husband to sit for her because she was an artist. And he sat for her wearing the women's clothing, and then he realized he was a transsexual, and that was the first ever transsexual surgery, and it was a two-part. The first part was to cut the male parts off, and the second part was to form the female parts. But they went through the whole thing, and the heartbreak with the woman went through the first part. He was happy, and then they went to the second part, and he died. Then the real story of heartbreak was with the woman, was with the wife, because I felt for her, because she lost her husband in the midst of him changing over. And it's a true story.
Who had the technology and the wherewithal to do that surgery back then?
It was a failure because he died. So nobody had the technology to do it, but they had one doctor who was willing to say, I think you're right. All of these men say they are women. They were born in the wrong bodies. And then that's where the stigma comes in with homosexuality. Because all babies in the womb are female at first. And testosterone comes and either turns their brain male and their genitals male, or it only turns the brain male. So there you are, stuck in a female body with a male brain. And that's where all of the, you know, the mix-up comes in. It's all hormonal. And then the reason why it's looked at so, you know, with like side eye is because if you did choose to be homosexual, you could choose that. It's a choice you can make. But there are some people who don't make the choice because their hormones are so, you know, mixed up in utero and womb. But like you said, nobody had the technology because obviously this person died in the first ever transsexual surgery that was ever attempted. And you can look it up online. The whole story is there. The wife was an artist, and there's actual art of the husband dressed as a woman. And the other movie was A Secret in Their Eyes, starring Julia Roberts, about these cops and the DA, and the cop's daughter gets killed. And it's just, they hold this long story looking for the killer, and the whole time she had him, like, chained up in the shed.
A Secret in Their Eye?
The Secret in Their Eyes. It was the guy from 12 Years a Slave. And Julie Roberts. And Tom Cruise's ex-wife, Nicole Kidman, she was in it too.
Okay, well, I'm going to have to check both of those out. Let me see what else. Okay, this one was not in the script, but tattoos. How many? How many are you going to get altogether?
I think I have like 18.
18, and you think, okay, and are you going to stop, or how many, what you going to do?
I don't know. I'm going to be somebody's grandma with tattoos all around my body. So, no, I'm not going to stop.
Okay.
I do it, like, once a year now. Like, last year on my birthday, I got two. This year on my birthday, I got two.
Which one are you the most proud of?
I'm not proud of any. It's just how I feel at the moment. So I guess the two I got a week ago would be my favorite because I call one Marilyn and one Liz because one looks like Marilyn Monroe and the other one looks like Elizabeth Taylor.
Atheism. So what? How's your reaction to, like, believing people around you? Like, do you kind of keep it to yourself? Are you out with it? Like, How do you manage that?
This is different. I mean, you might understand because you are Haitian. I live in the South, and not only the South, the Deep South. So when I walk out my door, Jesus is in my face. Somebody is talking about Jesus. Somebody is singing about Jesus. Jesus is on a license plate. Jesus is here. Jesus is there. I usually don't say anything until it's directly brought to me. So when it's directly brought to me, that's when I'm like, no, I'm good. Now, when they knock on the door, me and my husband go off. Get the fuck off the porch. We can tell you about God, that type of thing. But, like, I don't go looking for problems and looking for trouble. I have friends who are religious. I have family who's religious. So the conversation doesn't come up. It doesn't come up. But if it does come up, you know, I'm going to shut you down, and you're going to leave mad. But, no,
okay,
I don't just bring it up for no reason.
What about since your husband's parents, I guess his dad is the preacher? Like, how does that work with his family?
He lives in a house with us.
Oh, so he knows and he's cool.
Yeah. What can he do? He lives in our house.
I don't know. Maybe he can, I don't know, pray for you and... I don't know.
He might, but you know what? At the end of the day, he might know it's bullshit too. So, and that's the way I'll look at that.
Now, Locke and Rose describes statism as a type of religion. And I can definitely understand, I can definitely appreciate and understand that perspective. So my question to you is, based on your peers and the people that you know, which would be harder for people to let go, statism or their given religion?
Well, I mean, every situation is different. So it's going to always be according to the situation. But most of the time, the most religious people are the most patriotic people. So, I mean, it's
true.
What and what. At the end of the day, religion touches something emotional inside of you. When you're praying, you can feel it. You feel it in your face. You feel it in your heart. You feel it in, just like when you felt like you wanted to hit your brother for whistling at you. It was a visceral reaction. It was emotional. That's what religion is to people. That's why people know it's real. You know what I'm saying? That's why they know it's true. They don't understand that it's just a chemical reaction that's happening inside their body. They know that it's an external force touching them, making them feel like that. So at the end of the day, I cannot even get mad at people for feeling how they feel. But to answer your question, I don't know. I guess white Jesus is hard to give up. White Jesus is hard to give up. He's hard to give up. I mean.
White Jesus has been known to be handsome, depending on who plays him. So,
right. You're right.
So,
White Jesus is hard to give up, though.
Yeah. In fact, I'm very impressed by the Christian machine. I am very borderline depressed. I'm borderline depressed that Donald Trump is running for president and he's gotten that far. But I've lived through the Bush years, so I do not underestimate the power of stupid people. And I don't like to use that term because it kind of is antagonizing. But I've seen enough on my feed to make me just say, yes, there are very stupid people in the world. So I'm just going to call it for what it is. Also, like, the Christians are like, they're frothing at the mouth, I guess is the proper term. You know, they feel an opportunity is about to come where they're going to try to reverse a lot of things that's been going on. There's three movies that are either coming out or have come out.
I saw them. Listen. Remember last year, Gods and Kings, Exodus came out, and the year before that, Noah came out. So every year at Easter, they're putting out more religious movies. This year they put out like two or three of them. But for every year for the past 3 or 4 years, they put out a religious blockbuster. And Noah was good. Did you see Noah? As an atheist, Noah was great.
No, I have not seen Noah. I downloaded it. Noah was produced or directed by an atheist, but that's neither here nor there. I have to see it. But I kind of...
No, I'm going to tell you. Let me tell you. That movie was an atheist dream. It showed Noah for being the schizophrenic that he was. And when he talked about the beginning of Earth and the beginning of life, as he spoke, the stuff you saw on the screen was evolution. It was evolution through the ages. Noah was an atheist dream movie, and the religious people were sitting there watching it, and they didn't even know what they were watching.
Well, shit, now I gotta watch it. We have about 2 minutes left on the official time. I think we get some overtime, but during the overtime session, you can call. So if you're out there and you didn't call in, then that's your loss. You missed out, because I want to cover some more topics before we get off tonight. So the movies, just to be sure that we're on the same page, that are coming out are risen. There is God is not dead part two.
And that's bullshit, because God is not dead part one was bullshit.
Right, it's bullshit, but man, they are really pushing the narrative that they're innocent victims and that they're being bullied. And I cannot believe people are that stupid, but they are that stupid. So that's one that I still want to see, because the thing is, it's not about what I think, what I know. It's about how they manipulate the narrative and how the effect that it has on the masses. I really find that to be interesting. And also, there's the Young Messiah. Have you seen the promotions for that one?
I saw one.
Yeah. So again, I'm fascinated. You know, white people in the desert, and they have British accents. I've always been fascinated by that, because, you know, it's amazing how these Jews always seem to have British accents, and nobody seems to mind. That is very interesting to me. And also, there is a series that's coming out. There was a Bible series that it's like after the Bible. I don't know how well it did. And also, there's this one called Of Gods and Kings, I think, that's supposed to be coming out. So there's a lot of different things coming out to make that money, because religious people are spending money because they feel like, you know, they've been persecuted for a long time, and now they want to get back to against us as atheists through movies. So I just want to let you know.
You know, and like, usually when I see those movies and those previews, I gag. And I'm going to be honest, when I first saw the previews for Noah, I was like, oh my God, really? Are you fucking serious? The most childish, kiddie book in the Bible, y'all made a blockbuster movie about. And so one day I was at home, and I said, you know what, I'm just going to watch this movie. And I was sitting there with my mouth open, watching the movie like, I cannot believe this is an atheist movie. This is an atheist movie. This is so an atheist movie. So, I mean, I tried to watch Exodus, Gods, and Kings, but I couldn't, because it was whack. It was horrible. But I have to agree with you when you say the Christians really put out money because they want to see it. And then it's seeing it on the television, on the screen, it stirs that same emotion I was just talking about. It's just like when I was watching Titanic and I started crying, you know, because it was emotional, but it's something that they really believe in their heart. So, of course, they're going to put out money this year. That's why Madea movies make so much money, because at the end of the day, Tyler Perry is religious. And what's the biggest money base in the black community is the black Christian community. So, of course, those are going to make money. If I didn't have the morals that I have right now, I can't tell you how many times me, my husband, or me and my friend Christopher have sat and talked about opening up a mega church because we want to be rich. Now, I got the perfect story. Atheist, heathen, sees the light, finds Jesus, turns into the new Joel Osteen, the female version. I would make so much money. But I have morals, and I can't fool people like that. I would be rich if I
could. You know, I've talked about that with my members as well. We joke about it, but I'm secretly jealous because they have a base. They have a base, and they love that narrative, you know, that I found the light. I feel you. I you know, they always talk about how we don't have any morals. We have more respect for them in their mind
than they have
in their money than they have for themselves. Seriously.
Go ahead. I've been waiting. I thought you fell asleep.
No, I was watching the fight and everything, but I was listening the whole time. So, yeah. Sometimes I get, like, I had this thought. I was like, dang, I should have been an undercover atheist and just, like, going to churches and just, like, coming up with scams and traveling around the United States. I'd be, like, a millionaire by now. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. You know, I was thinking about, you know, like, Go ahead.
No, I was saying the way I can make it legit, though, and not feel bad is, like, okay, go in full force for, like, 2 years and then, like, take all the money, like, mega church. We are, like, the people out here, like, the mega churches out here. The preachers roll up in Lexus, Benzes, in private cars. They got jets. They got helicopters. They got gators. They got stylists. They got a stylist who have assistants. They got first ladies wearing furs in the pulpit. Like, we could go all out for, like, 2 years and then, like, ball out. And then after 2 years, even in, like, the little atheist thing, like, you know what? I don't know. Maybe man wrote the Bible. And then the next week, say, you know, maybe this happened. And then by the end of the day, you're going to turn everybody in the church into an atheist and still got your money so you can feel good about it. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, man, let's keep this magic juice in-house, dog, because you don't want nobody copying what's going on out here. I want to touch on a couple of things. I'm sorry to interrupt, but we're in overtime. The system might just cut us off unexpectedly, so we might have 10 minutes left. But what I wanted to say is, have you seen Marjo? Have you seen the movie Marjo?
Marjo? I don't know what that is.
Okay, so that's your homework. I'm going to type it to you on Facebook. It's basically exactly what you're talking about, but it's a documentary. It's on YouTube. You'll love it. You'll see what I'm talking about. Also, before we leave tonight, I just want to make sure this is the last thing I want to hear you talk about. This idea that I just was introduced through you is brutalism. Talk to me. What's going on? What is brutalism?
Well, brutalism is kind of like a joke, okay? Brutalism is like, okay, my friend, Donovan, who just died, he just passed, he was kind of like the father of brutalism. It was kind of like, in your face, I'm going to say anything. Don't fucking get offended. You see what I'm saying? So, like, in brutalist groups, you have white people using the word nigger with an E-R, not with an A. You have people saying anything in any type of way to anybody, and it's just about, to me, brutalism is about learning to control your emotion and not reacting from emotion, but being able to have a logical comeback, being able to think about what they're saying and be smart enough to logically have a smarter comeback. So brutalism is like putting it in your face. Fuck you, you're a fucking idiot. Why are you voting? Presidents aren't elected. You're stupid, you're sheeple, like that. Just talking to people like that. But the brutalist groups were filled with other brutalists, so they know you were going to talk like that. So you get back out into your regular social media, Twitter, Facebook, or whatever, and you're still talking like that. And all of a sudden, like, oh, Terri, she's an asshole. What is wrong with this girl? She's crazy. But no, I'm just like, I don't care about your feelings. Basically, you should be logical, but you're not. And it's hard to, because that's where I'm at. That's where I'm at in life. I'm like, I don't care about your feelings anymore. I'm not trying to convert people anymore. I can just converse with people who are like me. If I see someone with potential, like I just met with a guy. I met him on Facebook, but then he's from here, so I saw him playing his instrument out in town the other day, and I see he has potential, so I'm going to ease him into it like I would ease anyone else into voluntarism or anarchism, just, you know, saying nice things or asking them nice questions. But for the most part, for the masses, I'm just whatever. I don't care about your feelings. If you look up Christopher Cantwell or Donovan Bach or Alan Bach, you'll know exactly what brutalism is. Christopher Cantwell is an asshole, though, and he's kind of crazy. Now he supports Trump. He's really not an anarchist. He's a libertarian, but he's a racist. And then that was another problem that went along with brutalism. It got full of racists because they saw that white people and black people were talking to each other like that, saying nigger and this and that. And so it attracted all of the racists who really wanted to say that to us but couldn't in any other way. So all of the brutalist groups on Facebook were, like, infiltrated by racists who were just trying to hide their racism behind brutalism.
So how do you how how can you tell the difference?
I pretty much backed away from all of the brutalist groups. That's how you can't tell the difference. I mean, you can tell the difference. After you converse with someone so long, you deal with someone so long, you know if they really are just reacting from emotion and hating a person, what are you doing? Or if they're really, you know, trying to have a decent conversation and move the conversation to the next platform. So you can kind of pick out the people who are really racist.
Okay,
but I really backed away from most of the group. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. I was going to say that that's what I got. That's what I thought it was. When I put the word in the search engine for YouTube, it was about a type of architecture at first. And then I did see the man, Mr. Cantwell, the white guy. He's kind of heavy set. And he does mention that he does mention that he's an asshole. And I got the gist of it, that it's about keeping it real, not giving a fuck, but yet having a point to what you're saying. And I wonder if I can take that. I think I can, but, you know, but I think I prefer, in a perfect world, for people are keeping it real, you know what I'm saying? Like, I've always been like, man, listen, why can't I tell a girl, like, no, I'm not, it's not your dress, I want to have sex with you, this type of thing, you know, just keeping it real. Like, I just always prefer the kind of, like, the direct approach. So, but that's another thing that I was thinking about that you mentioned, logic. Are people born logical? Because I could tell you that, you know, I thought I was a critical thinker out of my mother's vagina, but I found out that when I took philosophy in college, it was a real smack in the face. And I also took debate. And those things really influenced me to understand how to think and speak and how to identify faultiness within myself. So I don't take it for granted that it's people are, like, born natural or they're logical or whatever. So what do you think about education and logic for the common person?
Well, I mean, logic is something you can learn. You can learn to be logical, but being logical means letting go of emotional-based thinking. If you can let go of your emotional-based thinking, you can think logically. And it's as easy as that. Okay, think about it like this. Think about it like this. A person with Down syndrome or a mentally challenged person or even a sociopath that has no filter, or a child that doesn't know to have a filter, they're going to think about it, they're going to be logical about it, and they're going to give you that direct answer, right? Now,
right.
If you want to worry about feelings and all those things, then that's when you start beating around the bush and all that. So if a person with Down syndrome or a child can give you a direct answer, then they were able to think logically about it, and their emotions didn't affect the answer they gave you. Do you see what I'm saying?
So can you be logical and emotional at the same time, or the two are mutually exclusive?
We're all emotional creatures. We're emotion-based. I made a post on Facebook about this the other day. I said that what they say about us, they say what separates humans from animals is our emotion, but it's wrong. I've heard several people say that. Well, we're different from the animals because we love and we have emotion. Wrong. All animals feel emotion, whether it's love or fear. Most animals react from fear or love, like dogs. What separates us from the animals is our ability to make decisions outside of our emotion. Once you're able to take your emotion and set it to the side and then make a decision, then you can be logical. You can never be logical and emotional at the same time. Emotion is always going to cloud logic.
Okay. We covered pretty much all the grounds. James, We are in overtime. You got any other thoughts, questions?
Who won the fight?
Well, I wanted to ask about how did you feel about the movie? Because we were talking about the movies, Gods of Egypt, and how they're using an almost all white cast, which is crazy. And then also too about the Nina Simone movie, how they're using Zoe Saldana. I want to know how you felt about that.
Okay, so I had some conversations about this today. Okay, I love Nina Simone. Nina Simone is my girl. Like, I love Nina Simone, right? So when I'm looking at this thing about that, and I'm like, why do you have this girl? It's logical to me that the person casting that movie would cast her because, one, they want a big-name person, you know? Two, they want the controversy to make you saying the name, to keep the name of the movie, to make the hype around it, to make you watch the movie. But they didn't think it through, because I'm going to watch the movie and I'm not going to be able to think about nothing but ugly-ass Zoe Saldana with a fake nose and blackface on. So at the end of the day, she's the wrong person to play that. She should not be playing Nina Simone.
I totally understand. I thought years ago they already had it to where Lauryn Hill would possibly play Nina Simone.
But Lauryn Hill has gone total crazy off the map. She don't pay her taxes. She's a person like me, you, and Reggie. So, of course, no, they're not going to let her in. Them Jews is like, bitch, get out. Bitch, no, no. Jews run Hollywood.
And she did say, she did say something, too, about, I guess, black people buying an album, and they kind of, like, really, like, kind of blackballed her after that one. I think she said she would rather her children starve before a white person, I guess, bought her album or something like that. It was just crazy.
I don't know. I don't know. I know they say she went crazy. She's not crazy. She just realized the industry she was working in was crazy. As far as the Nina Simone biopic, if you go on Netflix, last year, they came out with a Nina Simone documentary on Netflix. It's real funny to me that within a year, there's a throw-together-ass biopic with a light-skinned-ass girl with a fake nose playing Nina Simone. I feel like whoever made that movie was on Netflix watching the Nina Simone documentary and decided they wanted to make a movie, and they went and got the first big-name star they could get to play Nina, who was still black, so if we put her in blackface, it's not going to be that much. We're still going to get the traction, and we're going to get all the money. Zoe Saldana was the wrong person to play Nina Simone. I don't care how you put it. God, and the shit with the guys in Egypt, it's ridiculous to me. I'm going to say it like this. My friend told me once, he said, if you look at the hieroglyphs in Egypt, there are light-skinned blacks on some of those, and there are dark-skinned blacks on some of those. So it leads me to think and wonder, how did they have light-skinned blacks back then? But at the same time, they still had dark-skinned blacks. But Hollywood never depicts the dark-skinned blacks unless they are the slaves outside pushing, you know, the stones and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But, yeah, that's what I wanted to ask you about. And if you were a socially conscious person, and, you know, you would think if somebody offered you a role like that and you know, like, for a fact, you don't look nothing like this person, or,
dude, you know,
you're going to have to put, like, a makeup, you would think a person would turn it down and be like, you know what, nah, I can't do that, you know what I'm saying?
Let me just, like, me and you, you need to go friend me on Facebook so you can see what I wrote yesterday, because I posted about it, and then my friend was like, Jessica, Kyron, you know, Kyron and Jessica that was on the thing with us, Reggie?
Yeah,
so Jessica was like, well, did this person audition for it? And I said, look at me, being me, I would not have auditioned for it. Looking at myself, how I'm looking at Zoe Saldana, because we're both really, really light-skinned, I would not have auditioned for it. I'm not going to walk into a place and say, hey, I'm Nina Simone looking like Billie Holiday or Dorothy Dandridge, because I don't look like Nina Simone. Crazy to me. It's like, how I said, either they had her in mind, they wrote it for her, or she was the first big-name black star that accepted the role. It had
Is this movie in production or has it been completed?
No, this movie is about to come out.
Something like that. Yeah, they're showing pictures from it. It's about to come out. Yep. Mhm.
Okay. Well. Well, how about this? I don't know if anybody has done a spoof, and I'm sure there's been done, where they show like black people playing Japanese characters to kind of, show the point that, you know, hey, this is not correct, or black people playing white people, you know, like what can be done to kind of satirize this to show the problem?
You know what, I think other races, like you said, Chinese people, like, and other races or whatever, cultures like that, who don't have, like, I guess some of the same infighting, like we would, like you wouldn't see two Asian people fighting because one of them lighter than the other one, or one of them darker than the other one, or just, you know, I think a lot of them, they just sit back and enjoy the show. Like, they don't give a damn. Like, it ain't them. You know, they just sit back and like, oh, that's their issue. I'm just going to sit back and eat the popcorn and sip my tea.
Well, I don't know. I think part of the problem might be that there's not enough, I guess, there may not be enough production houses that are black that are willing to kind of do the same thing for white characters. I want to see a father's movie that's going to come out July 4th, 2017, where they put Dave Chappelle as George Washington, Key and Peele as Benjamin Franklin, and Thomas Jefferson, and Eddie Murphy is going to be, I don't know, whatever, and Kieran Pearson should be Frederick Douglass. So that's
don't
my
say
idea.
That. Don't tell him that, because it's just going to make his head even bigger, because he already has a huge head.
And you know what? This is off the beaten path, but like, do you know who Dr. Umar Johnson is, Terri?
I know who Umar Johnson is. Yes, I know who Umar Johnson is. Yes.
What do you think about the good doctor, the so-called doctor? What do you think about
it? You said a good doctor. Okay. Umar Johnson is a wonderful orator, not unlike Barack Obama, not unlike many of the people we know. Umar Johnson would probably be successful if he did open a school. However, Umar Johnson panders to a certain segment of the community. He does good, and he does okay, but he also works in half-truths and pseudoscience. So he is not always truthful in the things that he says. I respect him for whatever it is he does outside of being a child psychologist and working in, what, Baltimore schools? He's from, like, Baltimore or something like that, Philadelphia or something.
Yeah, Philly.
But I feel like he uses the name Frederick Douglass to get, like, more people interested in what he's saying. You know, I feel like he used it. But, hey, I can't knock the man. Let him get his hustle on. You know what I'm saying?
Umar Johnson definitely does.
I mean, he does it for publicity. Umar Johnson is Umar Johnson. I respect him for whatever.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, like, I mean, he sounds cool and he got some good ideas and everything, like you say, but you could tell with, like, some, like, half-truths and pseudoscience, like you said. But then, like, the more you listen to him, you kind of get that kind of, I don't know, creepy feeling from dude. Because he'd be like, yo, he's going to have the kids calling him Poppy. you know what I'm saying, or Papa or something like that. And then the kids, like, going to be, like, basically going to be living at the school, not kind of going home and stuff like that, you know what I'm saying? It's just kind of like, I don't know, it just kind of get that unclean feeling from dude a little bit every now and then when you see him and you be talking and stuff like
that. Well,
let me speak on that
for 1 second. Okay, so
okay.
As far as the kids living at the school, I would rather the children live at the school than live in the projects, on the street, watching their mama selling ass, their daddy selling drugs, if they know their daddy, rather than robbing and killing and raping and stealing. If that is the environment those children are living in, I would rather them be over there learning all that pseudoscience and half of that black history at the Frederick Douglass School for Boys than being in the hood and in the project doing all that, you know. But if that's not the children you're looking to get, if you're looking for other children, then I'm going to have that same question that you have. But if you're trying to take some kids out of the hood and show them something a little bit better, I have much love and much respect for that. You know, even if what you're saying is half-truths and pseudoscience and melanin supremacist theory, and that's what I like to say a lot of the time, all these hoteps, they have their melanin supremacist theory. There is some fact in there, you know, it's based in some fact that, you know, the black body has more muscle tone than any other race. The black body is easily more physically fit with less exercise. You know, there are genetic reasons why the melanin supremacist theory is real. But at the end of the day, no, we're not gods and we're not this and we're not that over any other person. We're equal to all the other people. So if we're gods, then white people are gods and Asians are gods. We're all gods. We're not supreme to any of those other people. That's my only problem with the hotep shit.
See, I understand, because he even gave a good example, you know, because, you know, when the kids, they be at home with their parents are still under the program, you know, so when they get, the kids are coming home, you know what I'm saying, he got the program at the school, and they come home, then they get deprogrammed, you know what I'm saying, or some of the energy and knowledge that he put in them, they get sucked out when they come home, because all the street stuff, that, all the BS that be going on, but it's just the part when he's like, yo, they're going to call me Poppy. They're going to call me Papa. You know what I'm saying? Just the way
I didn't hear that, but that is really weird. That's weird as shit. That's weird.
Yeah.
That's weird.
You got to see the interview when he's like, yeah, this is bad at 30. They're going to call me Papa. All the kids are coming. It's going to be at the school. They're going to be around me. And they're going to call me Papa. I'm Big Poppy or whatever. I was like, huh? Huh?
You
know what?
Hey, are you even teaching Spanish at this school, nigga? It's Poppy. Okay.
Yeah.
I don't understand. That's another thing, though. I know we're off the air, y'all. So I talked to a friend. He called me. We're not off the air. Okay, so I talked to a friend. He called me for my birthday, and we had a little good, like, two-hour conversation or whatever. I said that I was going to go ahead and do stand-up for my birthday. For this year, that's my goal. I want to do stand-up. I want to be a comedian. I think I'm funny. Sometimes other people think I'm funny, but I think, you know, sometimes my jokes won't land. But
yeah.
I think that's my goal for this year. I'm 34. I made 34, like, on the 22nd. So, like, a week and a half, 2 weeks ago, I turned 34. So my goal is to do stand-up comedy.
Yourself.
I'm young. I'm middle-aged.
I say young. I'm 35, about to be 36, so be young still to me, because I ain't old.
Right. Like, 34 is the new 24. Really, when my mama was 24, that's the equivalent of my 34.
All right, let me ask you a question. Now that you're in your 30s, does your body feel like old, or does your body still feel like you were, like, in your 20s or any teens? Because to me, physically, I still feel like I have a body of a teenager. My body, I have no aches, no pains, no nothing.
Well, I did drugs from, like, 15 to 24. So, no, 15 to 27. So I don't really know what my body felt like in my 20s. But I feel damn good right now.
Okay. That's what's up.
You didn't expect that answer.
And they say you're as young as you feel.
I'm going to tell you like this. Okay. So I started feeling fat the other day because I saw some pictures of myself, and I was like, oh, shit, it's winter. I done got fat. I went out, and I worked out 3 times in 1 week, and I already saw the differences. So either I still have a young body or I have really good genes. All I have to do is work out for 2 weeks straight, and I'll be good all the way good. It's just getting my ass up because I hate working. I hate working for people. That shit, like, kills my soul and my energy. So when I work for other people and I come home, I just want to sit down. But, like, if my husband's working and taking care of me and I don't do anything, then I work out twice a day.
I can definitely feel you about the working thing because I'm a creative person. And it's like every time I'm working for somebody else, it feels like it's just killing my creativity.
It kills me. It kills my vibe. It kills my life and my soul. I just like I don't care. I don't want to be here. But I need the money.
The time I'm spending making money for somebody else, I could be doing my art.
Right. Totally, though. Like, we weren't meant as people to go to work and work 40 hours a week. We was like, we're not set up for that. That is not what we're meant to do. We're meant to raise our children, live our lives, build our house, catch our fish, cook it, and eat it, you know? We're really not meant to sit at nobody's job 40 hours a week.
So where does 40 hours a week come from?
I think that came with the new deal. Yeah, I'm gonna say this, like, Henry
Roosevelt,
Ford, he like
new
was
deal.
The first one to. They had to come up with, like, I think it was Henry Ford who was the first person to implement the 8-hour shift and 40 hours a week, and then the government saw that and they implemented it.
And then Roosevelt
like,
in 1933, the new deal. In order to get your little Social Security insurance and your Medicaid or whatever, all of your programs, you had to do certain things. But either way, it came from the New Deal, Roosevelt's New Deal, 1933. That's when the 40-hour work week came in.
Okay.
But it's a bunch of bullshit because, like, really, at the job I'm on now, oh, my God, I'm going to get fired for saying this. I really only work like 5 hours a day and then I go home because I'm on salary, right? So, like, I work 5 or 6 hours and then I go home.
Lucky
because,
you.
Because, you know, I can do that shit. But, like, if I have to sit at somebody's job, like, I used to be a salary manager doing 10-hour shifts, but I had to work 12-hour shifts because it went over every fucking day. And I was like, oh, my God, I hate it. I was making good money, getting paid every week, but my life sucked because I was at that place. And I worked there 6 weeks, and I quit. And I'm like, I'm not cut out for this. Like, I'm really not cut out for working for somebody like that. Like, that's why I like my job right now so much. It's really laid back. I come in super early. I can leave early. I can, you know, it's kind of laid back like that. I'm really
let me ask you a question.
Mhm.
Have you heard of Dr. Boyce Watkins?
I did. I do know Boyce Watkins, and I do know the controversy that he's going through right now. He, like my friend said, pull up a chair at the Uncle Tom table, because we're all Uncle Toms for questioning the liberal leftist agenda.
What was the controversy? Because I normally I'm up on what's going on with, because I subscribe to his YouTube channel. But what controversy is going on now?
So, like the day before yesterday, he made a Facebook post that said, "Why?" Basically, paraphrasing. I need y'all black people to tell me where Donald Trump said he doesn't like black people. Show me where he's racist. He said, I think people are putting this in y'all heads and y'all feel like Donald Trump is racist, but you never heard him say a racist thing out of his mouth. And so all of a sudden,
man,
he's a race traitor. He's a. This is
oh,
the thing.
Man.
Donald Trump is an actor. Donald Trump is an actor. He said 20 years ago he was going to run for president, and he did. And people just don't pay attention to what's going on.
I think he's working for, like, secretly, he's, like, working for, like, the Hillary, like, Hillary Clinton.
That nigga working for the Democrats.
Like
he is. He is working for the Democrats to get Hillary elected. Hillary is going to be our president. Hillary is the next president. It was chosen back in the 90s. They said after the first black president, we'll have the first woman president, and then we'll have the first gay president. We got Obama, we're about to have Hillary, and then the gay one will come. Mark my words, what I'm telling you. Hillary is the next president, and Donald Trump works for Hillary Clinton.
I bet you the gay one is going to be a Republican.
It probably will.
No.
It probably will.
I bet that. I can guarantee you he's going
to
be like
it
a
has
Republican.
To. It has
he's gonna
to.
Be like, he's going to be that Republican that crosses all, you know what I'm saying? He's going to be like the Republican version of Obama. He ain't black, but he's gay.
And then what happens after that is one world government, and we don't have no more Democrats, no more Republicans. Everybody just comes together and lets somebody rule over all of us. Like, people really need to wake up. They gotta wake the fuck up. This shit happened in New Hampshire already. All them people moved to New Hampshire and said, fuck you, we're going to take over the government. And that's what they did. Now, if you go to New Hampshire and you try to run for office, they ask you, are you affiliated with the Free State Project? Are you a part of the Free State Project? Have you ever been in contact with the Free State Project? Because all of those anarchists and libertarians moved to New Hampshire, and they all ran for office, and they won. It's possible.
Well,
it's reachable. It's attainable. What you were saying?
What is it?
How about
it? No, I'm sorry. I just wanted to know what the Free State Project is, because I don't know.
Free State Project? Well, all these libertarians and anarchists moved to New Hampshire and took over the government. They all ran for government, and they got elected because all of their friends moved there with them. So now, in New Hampshire, there are no mandatory insurance laws. There's no sales tax. There are no frivolous laws that infringe on your freedom to do anything. New Hampshire is the freest state in the United States right now because everybody decided to move over there who were libertarians and anarchists. And they effectively took over the government. It shouldn't even have to be that hard, though. We should just be able to do what we're going to do, but it's not. You got to go ahead.
So let me ask you, so you would be, as far as like, do you remember the thing that was going on with the, I think it was the Bundy rants or something, how they basically stormed the federal animal protection something, building or something like that, and I guess they were going against the federal government.
They didn't storm it. They just went over there to it and was chilling. They didn't, like, the people were just over there. The fucking cops and shit and the FBI or whoever, ATF or whoever came, they came. But, like, the people were just over there, like, fuck this, I'm tired of you taking our land.
Okay.
But, I mean, like, if you own some land or whatever, and you just chilling, living your life, and all of a sudden the government come and says, this part of your land is not my land. You can't use this no more. When you do, how would you feel? You'll feel like, fuck you, dude. This is mine, right?
Yeah, I would.
So would you just give it to him?
Nah. Yeah, you ain't even get nothing from me.
Oh, no, they got ways to coerce you, man. I mean, let's keep it real. But you wouldn't be happy about it. That would be, I think, the most.
Yeah,
I feel like in my lifetime, the way I'm going to die is them people going to be at the door shooting up me and my husband and my kids. Like, that's how I'm going to fucking die in the end. Like, living through Hurricane Katrina, having M16s, 9s, all type of guns pointed at your head for doing nothing more than just being out there. Like, I've seen the side of the government that most people have never seen. Like, even regular black people that get harassed by police, I've seen that side of the military. Like, I've had a state trooper pull a 12-gauge shotgun and put it to my head for trying to get in a van to get out of New Orleans. But it was a trap. They left the keys in it on purpose. Like, shit that I've seen, people have not seen.
What do you have to
see? I've seen the fucking police going in the store, looting the store, and telling us, wait at the door till we get through taking all the stuff we're taking, then you can get whatever you need after we're done. Like, this is not normal stuff people see.
Also, there's a video when, I guess, Hurricane Katrina was going on of, I guess, the police or the military was, like, basically, like, kicking in people's doors and stuff like that. Granted, it
taking
was on
their
one of those, it was on the alley of Jones. Yeah, they were taking people's guns and stuff like that. I didn't know how real that was because it was on Alex Jones. I heard about it on Alex Jones, and you know you can't really believe 75% of
it. Well, I'm about to tell you how it went. Okay, like, I had one gun with me. It was cute. It was a little 380 with a purple beam on it. So whatever, that was the only gun we had on us. Walking, I decided to walk. We was in the projects. I lived in the projects. I was in there. We still had water and we had gas. So we was able to take a hot bath and we were able to cook. A week after Katrina, we were still in the house, still had all that. They finally started turning everything off. They turned off the gas first, then they turned off the water. So we went and walked to the Superdome, got in the line, stood there, and they had a barrel. And they said, put your guns in the barrel. And so we got up there to the barrel, and when he said, put your guns in the barrel, I turned around and left. So they were telling us to give our guns, and at the same time, they were going to white people's houses, kicking in the doors and taking guns. They wasn't in the hood. They was in white neighborhoods taking people's guns. And that, I think that's where the outcry came, because they wasn't in the hood. You know, like, all the hood people was out in the streets. We were looting and we were getting food and we were doing whatever, trying to get out of the city because we didn't have a car. They were off in the better neighborhoods. They were in the people's houses going through their jewelry. They were going through their guns, their jewelry, their money, their safes. That's the shit the fucking government was doing during Katrina. The police.
Yeah. In the video, yeah. It was an old white lady.
I feel like once you've seen that, it's no going back. Like, you will never, ever, ever believe in government again after that.
Okay, well, you know, like, just like in religion, I think that a lot of times if you take away someone's, I guess, religion, a lot of times they ask you for a replacement. When they ask you, well, now that I stopped believing in Jesus, now how am I going to do X, Y, and Z? What? How would you, like, answer people's angst about anarchy and, you know, like, needing a replacement to do certain things that they feel that the government is responsible for, like national defense, et cetera?
The government isn't responsible for anything. We're only responsible for ourselves.
Answer that question. Let me see. Well, we are in overtime. The time is now 12:13 a.m. on the Eastern time. Is the fight over, James?
No, actually, this is like the third round right now, and it's not looking too good for my fighter, the one I like.
Okay.
It's not looking too good for Holly Holm.
Okay. Well, I downloaded successfully King, both movies, Gods and Kings, and Noah. So she talked about Noah a lot. So I'm gonna go check that out. I think we if you want, we can do a part two, Terri. What do you think?
Definitely, anytime.
Okay. So before we,
I'm almost asleep. Like I had fell asleep. If we could do it like an hour earlier, that would be good.
Oh yeah. I only do it at 9:30 my time because I want the kids to go to sleep so that it does. You don't hear like a little girl walking in here asking all kinds of questions. But yeah, like just
well, like
you
did with
to
me
you.
Tonight because my son walked in and asked questions. He's still in my face asking questions. Y'all didn't hear him?
Yeah, I heard him. And
I heard him a couple times, but he was good.
Yeah, and that's really the reason why it's at 9:30 Eastern time. But yeah, if my guest wants to do it earlier, that's cool. You know, just we'll just communicate and we'll make it happen. The next show I'm gonna have is gonna be on Monday, where I'm gonna have Ron Young, and we're gonna do an interview, and we're gonna talk about mostly polyamory. So let me know when you want to do it. Again, Mondays and Sundays are my off days, so most likely it'll be one of these nights. But we'll set something up for part two, and maybe you can ask me some questions. I'd like to get on the hot seat too, or we can talk about whatever the issue of the day is when the day comes. So let's get some last words in. And go from there.
Last words? I don't have any last words.
Okay. Well, James, anything you got?
No, I can't wait to the next show because it's kind of crazy that he's going to be talking about polyamory because there's a show, like a TV show. With this white couple and they're like doing polyamory actually, and it's called something with poly in it.
I have an actual friend on Facebook that's in the actual Liberty Movement that actually lives in New Hampshire, and it's called the Free Love Show or something. They do a radio show and they're polyamorous. That's not my cup of tea or my type of hype actually, because you know I'm jealous. I'm jealous or whatever. As far as my husband is concerned, because he belongs to me, you know what I'm saying? But I feel like, you know, to each his own, and whatever makes you happy, you know, that do you. You know, I'm not like, I'm totally open or whatever.
Okay.
Maybe if me and him break up, you know, or something happens, who knows what will happen with me in the future. But, like, I've already told him and my children that if me and him get a divorce, I will be marrying for money and I'll be playing Anna Nicole. So if the old man wants to go and get him something else on the side, I'll be polyamorous all day as long as I get my coin.
Well, there you go. I mean, just keeping it real. That's what I like.
Hey.
It should be a very educational show this Monday, 9:30 Eastern Time. So call in, ask questions. Let's talk about jealousy. Let's talk about coins, cold men, whatever it is. I'm down. You know what I'm saying? Because the dude is cool. Let me tell you, like, this is somebody that is going to bring it, you know, because there's logic and all kinds of stuff involved. You'll see. So I want to thank you for your time. I know it's late. I want to thank your sons, your husband, for letting us borrow you for a few hours. We really
appreciate
it. Oh,
my husband's gone to work. I'm good now. I'm up. I'm about to watch House of Cards. I appreciate y'all having me on the show, though.
Okay.
No problem.
Get
your calling.
No problem.
All right, so I'm gonna put the intro music now, and then I'm gonna watch me some Noah. And as soon as I finish watching it, I'll let you know what I think of it. All right?
Definitely, it's really good.
Also, so I'm gonna send you a friend request.
Do that, yeah, definitely, because I think me and you see eye to eye on some.
All right. So good night, everybody.
Thank you for having me. Thank you, and good night.
Good night. next.
Napa guy knows not to judge a man by his car's multicolor paint job or absence of modern gadgetry. Who cares if it's technically old enough to vote and the windows are powered by the strength of your left arm? Your monthly payment is zero, and it'll stay that way. Because with over 500,000 parts and a little Napa know-how, you can keep anything on the road. She may not be pretty, but she's all yours. That's Napa know-how.
Napa know-how.
Back pain can keep you from living your life to its fullest potential. At the Back Pain Center at Gwinnett Medical Center, relief is in reach. Our team of experts will quickly diagnose your condition and determine the best course of treatment for you. Download your free copy of Understanding Back Pain at gwinnettmedicalcenter.org/backpain. Stop living with pain and get back to the things that matter most. This is Gwinnett Medical Center. This is now.